Duly noted.
Madam President, this week the Senate continues to press forward on a number of congressional review actions, in this case of disapproval, that will roll back or repeal many Obama-era regulations that have hurt people across the country and strangled our economic growth. By doing away with excessively burdensome rules and regulations, we're delivering on our promise to the American people to actually do what we can to help the economy, to grow the economy, to create jobs, and not hurt it with unnecessary and expensive and burdensome red tape. Earlier this year, we began the legislative process to deliver on our biggest promise, repealing and replacing Obamacare with more affordable and more accessible health care options, options that will work for all American families. The American Health Care Act, introduced in the House on Monday, is the first step in fulfilling that promise. Obamacare is collapsing. It's already failed countless families across the country, and it's forced people off of good insurance plans that they liked and strong-armed them to sign up for plans that were more expensive, offered less care, and didn't even let them use the doctor of their choice. So we would be revisiting health care even if Hillary Clinton had been elected president of the United States, because Obamacare is in a meltdown mode. Obamacare has also saddled our economy with more than $1 trillion in new taxes. Most of those taxes are so hidden that most Americans are probably not aware of the fact that there is even a tax charged on their premium for their health insurance policy, for example. Well, all these taxes end up being absorbed and have to be paid by American families. And it's at its very core, the individual mandate of Obamacare was a major power play and overreach by the federal government. Basically, what it said is if you don't buy the government-prescribed health insurance plan, we're going to fine you. We're going to penalize you. The government should not be able to force anyone to spend their own hard-earned money for something that they don't want, but buy under threat of financial penalty. The American people have spoken up loudly and clearly and rightfully demanded that Congress do better, and we will. Since the 2010 timeframe in which our colleagues on the other side of the aisle passed Obamacare with 60 votes in the Senate and a majority in the House and with the White House, they've lost the majority in the Senate, they've lost the majority in the House, and they've lost the White House. I think Obamacare has been one of the major reasons why, because people, once the more they learn about it, the less they like it. And they don't appreciate Washington forcing them to do things that they don't want to do with their own money. About 2 months ago, one of my constituents in Texas wrote me about her skyrocketing health care costs. Before last year, her premium was about $325 a month. A short time later, that was revised to $436 a month. This same Texan later moved from one city to another, and because of her change of address, her premium jumped to $625 a month, starting at $325, now $625. In 2017, thanks to Obamacare, it went up again to an astronomical $820 a month. Started at $325 before Obamacare, and now is $820 a month. I don't know many people who could absorb that kind of increase in their health care insurance premium. So about a year, her monthly health care payment jumped by more than 150%. 150%. That's hardly what I would call affordable, and thus the misnamed Affordable Care Act. It should be the Unaffordable Care Act. To make matters worse, she then found that her provider would be putting a halt to individual plans in Texas, something that's been a reoccurring theme in my state and across the country. So that while President Obama said, if you like your plan, you can keep your plan, as a result of Obamacare, she was not able to keep her plan. And so she had to find a new plan and a new doctor, a plan ultimately with less care, less flexibility, and even a higher price. So suffice it to say, for this constituent of mine, and for millions more like her, Obamacare is not working. Obamacare is not affordable, and it's hurting Texans. So it's time for Congress to keep its promise that we've made in every election since, that given the privilege of governing, of being in the majority, being in a position to change things, we would repeal and replace Obamacare with options that fit the need of all Americans and their families at a price they could afford.
Would my friend from Texas yield for a question?
I will not.
Okay.
Not at this time. Fortunately, we now have a president in the White House who clearly sees the failure of Obamacare and wants to do something about it. And Republicans in Congress have introduced a bill now being marked up in the House that the president can actually sign once it's passed to get us out of this mess. The American Health Care Act is the vehicle to do just that. And I'm glad President Trump endorsed the plan earlier this week. It is a work in progress. The House committees are marking it up as we speak. There will be changes along the way, but ultimately the House will pass the bill and send it to the Senate. And then we'll have an opportunity to offer our amendments during the course of its passage. The important point to make, though, is this legislation will actually put patients first so that they're not forced into a plan that they don't want or provides coverage that they can't afford. It does away with the outrageous new taxes and the penalties that have made the economy worse off and made life harder for American families. The legislation will also give families more flexibility so that they can get the health care specific to their needs and that actually works for them. If they decide, for example, to get a major medical policy, which is relatively inexpensive, and then use a health savings account to use pre-tax dollars to put in a health savings account to pay their regular doctor's visits, they will have the flexibility to do that. So this legislation promotes sensible reforms that will make sure big ticket items like Medicaid also are put on a more sustainable fiscal path. I've heard some suggestions that this legislation actually guts Medicaid. Well, that's false. That's not true. It actually continues at current levels in this shared state and federal program, but it's subject to a cost of living index that will actually put Medicaid on a more sustainable path. Just as importantly, it'll also return the authority back to the states to come up with the flexible programs they need in order to deal with the specific health care needs of the people in their state. So this legislation makes sure that Medicaid doesn't lose sight of its design, which is to serve the most vulnerable among us who can't afford access to quality health care. It provides them that access and a better access by providing flexibility to the states. We know that the states and the federal government spend an awful lot of money on Medicaid. In Texas, for example, my state spent close to a third of its budget on Medicaid last year, a third of all state spending. And it's uncapped, so it goes up every year by leaps and bounds. Under the American Health Care Act, Medicaid will be tied to the number of people in the state using it, a per capita rate, which makes sense, and it represents the first major overhaul of the program in decades. So Obamacare left us with unchecked government spending, more taxes, and less health care options. This bill is the opposite of Obamacare in every way. It will control spending in a common sense way. It will repeal Obamacare's taxes and the individual and employer mandate, and it will provide more flexible free market options for families across the country. That's not just about the bumper sticker or the advertisement. That is actually what's contained in the legislation. And I look forward to working with my colleagues in the House and the Senate and now in the Trump administration to get this done in the next few weeks.